the original, that was the original lane. This never existed at the time, back in 1995. That was the original lane. And rumour has it that that part of the lane there was the getaway. So here we are in the village of Rettendon. The Rettendon Murders, also known as the Range Rover Killings, happened on 6 December 1995 in the village of Rettendon in Essex. Three drug dealers were shot in a blue Range Rover. Registration plate was F424NPE. This all happened down a small farm track, roughly between 6:45pm and 8pm. I believe that this farm track, which we are on, is called Workhouse Lane. However, I have seen a few YouTubers who, unfortunately, no disrespect guys, you've gone to the wrong Workhouse Lane. The other Workhouse Lane, I believe, is over that way somewhere, which we will probably try and find later on today. But this is the original Workhouse Lane. And as you can see from the cones to the hedge sides, this was the lane. All this has been extended. I would say, and I'm not an expert, I've got no detective mind, I'm not intelligent, but looking around, I can see how easy it would have been for our gunmen, or the gunmen, to be hiding in here. It's not hard, is it, to hide yourself here, waiting to pounce with shotguns. It's not hard at all. It's quite a strange feeling, actually, being here after being intrigued by the story. Pretty much since I think I was 17 at the time. It's 1995, so yes, I was 17. I remember it on the news. Rumour has it, I mean, as I said, I'm no expert, but I've had the privilege of knowing some police officers all my life, really. And yeah, the gossip with policemen, when you just casually chat, you know, as you do, about footprints were only found walking away from the vehicle. So it seems to me like the killer or the killers were in the car. They were driven here. Now, when you've got three Essex boys, three drug dealers, who did have a bit of a reputation, Pat Tate, Greg Rolfe, and Tony Tucker, they weren't little boys, they were big men. Rumour has it, Patrick Tate could literally fill a door. He was a big man. And they were hard men. And the night they were murdered, not one of them had a tool on them. Not one of them had a gun, a knife, a screwdriver, a chisel, knuckle duster, nothing. They were completely and utterly unarmed. Which to me sounds like they were lured here by someone obviously who they trusted. A friend of theirs. There was no signs of, well, hard to say, there's no signs of struggle because they're all shot, but they were just completely and utterly unarmed. So the reason that they were here is very strange, and I don't think anyone will know the truth. So what I think we'll do, we'll take a walk back up this, the original part of the track. But yeah, the Range Rover was here. It was here, the gate that's been featured in all the films. We've got Essex boys, Sean Bean, bonded by blood, and Rise of the Foot Soldier, which has shown the Range Rover coming down this track, stopping at a gate, which I believe must have been about here, and then the killers jumping out of the bushes. One thing that I've noticed on YouTube, and watching all the YouTubers regarding this case, and I must admit, thank you guys, you've been really helpful. with my research over all of this, one thing that has not been mentioned, which I find quite difficult to understand, is the fact that it wasn't just a case of three drug dealers being shot. I personally believe that it was down to a victim called Leah Betts, and it was a revenge act. It was a revenge shooting based on Pat Tate, Tony Tucker and Craig Rolfe. God rest her soul. I'm not here to dig up the past. I'm not here to cause any problems or aggravation or arguments, but I personally believe that it was Leah Betts was the reason that these three gentlemen were shot dead in the Range Rover. I think all films, all three films, have indicated that from the courtroom, the outcome of the court case has decided that the story is what we've seen in all the films. However, I personally believe it was a bit more beyond that. I don't have a lot of evidence. I don't have, in fact, have a leg to stand on, but I've got a belief and I'm entitled to that belief. As I said, I'm not here to dig up the past, but Leah Betts attended Raquel's nightclub for her 18th birthday back in 95. It was there where she took a pill, which was pure ecstasy tablet. She consumed, I believe, 9 pints of water in 90 minutes, something like that. And she actually died of water intoxication. In other words, she drank so much water it killed her. Her brain swelled up and she died. Because of that, she was put in a coma. Because of the death of Leah Betts, happened at Raquel's, as we all know, Tony Tucker and Pat Tate were in control of the door of Raquel's nightclub. So if you're in control of the door of the nightclub, you can let who you want in. You can let certain drug dealers in who are going to sell your drugs for you. So they're onto a bloody good business. And because of Death of Leah Betts, who was sold a tablet in Raquel's nightclub, I personally believe it was a revenge shooting. It was a revenge killing. I'm not saying who it was or who done it, but Leah Betts' father was a firearms officer in the police force. He's going to have contacts. I'm not saying it was an inside job from the police, but just a little bit suspicious if you put two and two together. So what we do now is we're going to walk back up the original lane, back onto Main Road, which in fact is actually the Main Road. It's called Main Road. It's hard to realise how close the Main Road is to the site, because in the films it looks like they drove for miles down these country lanes, and they didn't. Main Road's just over here. And also, if we have a look up here, this property, it was so close to the shootings. Very bizarre. But the story of the Rettendon murders, also known as the Range Rover killings, happened on the 6th of December 1995 in the village of Rettendon, Essex. The incident was followed by a major police investigation, which was Operation Century, and has been the subject of many books and feature films. All films have been based on the court case verdict, which I find all movies swing to that one decision, that it was Jack Welms and Mickey Steele. I'm no expert. I personally believe it wasn't Mickey Steele and Jack Welms. But how can I prove it? It's not up to me to prove it either. I'm not here to cause problems. It's just my belief. See how close the main road is to the start of the original lane. Okay, so as I've noticed on a some fellow YouTubers about Workhouse Lane. This is Workhouse Lane. This was not the site of the Range Rover killings where we've just been. What's the exact location? However, I've noticed a few people coming to Workhouse Lane, which is this one and not the other one. So please try not to get yourselves confused. You'll be very disappointed. One thing I found quite intriguing about the Range Rover shootings itself was that the Range Rover Vogue, which was an F424 MPE, was purchased just 3.5 weeks before the shootings. And even though Pat, Tony and Craig were shot in it, the vehicle was still being used up until the 1st November 2009. So whoever brought that vehicle must be a huge sort of ego boost, I imagine. It's a good icebreaker, if you know what I mean.